my pleasure to welcome you all. We are so excited to host today's conversation. I will leave the podium ASAP because I know that you all are chomping at the bit to hear from our esteemed panelists. But I first would like to say thank you to our wonderful partners who are hosting and who put together this program. And we look forward to doing this again with you in the future. You're always welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you, Verizon, for hosting us today. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rosa Mendoza, and I'm the president and CEO of ALLvanza. Before we start, thank you all, by the way, for joining us today for this very important conversation. Before we begin today's discussion, I want to acknowledge my partners, my event partners, the Multicultural Media, Telecom, and Internet Council. Thank you, Robert, for your partnership. OCA, Asian Pacific American Advocates. Thank you, Eric, wherever you are, for your partnership. And LGBT Tech. Thank you, Carlos. Always a pleasure to work with all of you. We at ALLvanza are always pleased to work alongside these partner organizations to present the newest installment in our Moving Underserved Communities Forward event series, Election 2024, Implications for the Innovation Ecosystem. With the upcoming November election, the future of the innovation ecosystem is at a pivotal moment. Whether under a Democratic or Republican administration, the policies introduced could dramatically influence its sustainability and growth. And today, our panel of experts will share insights into what each potential outcome could mean for this vital sector. We look forward to a very lively discussion. Thank you all for joining us. And now we'd like to welcome my colleague, Carlos Gutierrez, who will introduce our moderator. Thank you again for joining us.
Thank you so much, Rosa. Thank you, everyone, for being here. We really appreciate it. Hopefully, we're going to have a great conversation. I know we will. It is my pleasure today to introduce our moderator for this powerhouse panel. It is Jerry Waldron. Jerry is a partner at Covington and Burling, and he previously served as a chairman of the firm's communications and media group, practice group. Jerry has also testified on communications and internet issues before the FCC, the House of Representatives Energy and Commerce Committee, the House Judiciary Committee, the Maryland Public Utility Commission, the Nevada Gaming Commission, and on and on and on. And he's a graduate of the University of Virginia and the Duke University School of Law. Thank you so much for moderating today, Jerry, and over to you. Thank you, everyone.
I appreciate that. Thank you all. And just to get the show started, why don't we just quickly go down and let all the panels introduce themselves in just a 1 minute about sort of who you are and your organization, and then we're going to dive into the questions. We'll have an opportunity for audience Q&A towards the end. So with that, how about we kick off with you, Jonathan?
Yeah, I guess I'll be the first to kick things going. My name is Jonathan Cannon. I'm a policy counsel at the R Street Institute. Our slogan is Free Markets, Real Solution. We are a free market think tank dedicated to pragmatic solutions that look at free market approaches to a number of issues. On the tech and innovation team, obviously, my focus is on telecom and broadband issues. And, you know, ACP has obviously been a huge part of my work over the last year and a half. And, you know, it's kind of a shame to see where that program's going. But I'm looking forward to this discussion to talk about both telecom and other tech issues and kind of what we can look forward to the next 4 years.
First of all, thanks for hosting this to all of the hosts, and I'm really pleased to be here, and thanks, Jerry, for moderating. So I'm Randy May. I'm president of the Free State Foundation. The Free State Foundation is a free market. Here's the way we describe ourselves: a free market, property rights protective, free speech protective, and rule of law oriented think tank. It's kind of interesting that the two free market think tank representatives here are on the right and you guys are on the left for me, but be that as it may. Now, I didn't think about that.
I meant to wear a red tie.
We at the Free State Foundation, as many of you know, we focus most heavily on telecom issues, communications policy, the stuff we're going to be talking about today. We also do intellectual property. We spend a lot of time on administrative law and constitutional law issues, often as they relate to some of the things we're going to be talking about. So I'll leave it at that. And again, I'm really pleased to be here with so many friends here today.
Thank you. Thanks again to everyone for putting this together. My longtime friend, Rosa Mendoza, we've been in a lot of battles together throughout the years, and everyone here I've worked with at one point, well, not everyone, but a lot of you in the room I've worked with at some point. I'm Larry Gonzalez with the Raben Group, and we are a government affairs firm here in Washington, D.C., although we have offices all across the country in California, El Paso, Texas, and other places. We've been around for about 20 years. The founder of the organization, Robert Raben, is a former assistant attorney general under the Clinton administration, and I joined about a year or two later after he founded the firm, so considered a founder as well. But, you know, over a 20-year period, you end up representing a lot of folks in this space, and we've pretty much done that, whether it's Verizon or AT&T or Google. One on our roster list currently is Charter Communications, and so a lot of folks, you know, that are familiar to people and that will, you know, possibly reference in terms of some of the things we'll be talking about today, but just excited to share information with each other, really, more than me speaking at everyone. So just happy to be here.
My name is Davey McKissack. I'm a vice president at the Glen Group. We're a tech-focused public affairs firm. We work with our clients on many of the issues we're going to talk about today, trying to sort of translate those for whether it's consumer audience, whether it's federal audience or state audience, really taking the complex, really detailed programs and regulations that we're going to talk about today and making those make sense and translating those into winning campaigns for clients.
Great. We're in an unusual, if not unprecedented, situation in which we have a administration that has some potential to continue, though with a different sort of leader and probably some different agendas. And we have a contender who is an old administration who is, we know something about from their 4 years. So I'm going to start with those on the right, my left, and sort of throw the first question to both of you. In terms of the first 100 days of a Trump administration, what can we expect, or what do you expect is perhaps the best way, in terms of the impact on the innovation ecosystem?
I mean, first of all, I'm tired of hearing that everything's unprecedented. It'd be nice to have some precedent at a certain point. I mean, I think it's a great point. I mean, we've seen, by and large, what the first Trump administration looked like. I mean, looking from an administrative standpoint, one of the first things he did was create a policy where every new regulation led to two previous regulations being taken away. So the regulatory agenda I could see continuing in some capacity. You know, looking at the FCC, if a Commissioner Carr became a Chairman Carr, I think we can see very clearly what his agenda would look like, especially coming out, you know, from the gate. I think a lot of the, you know, kind of last minute aggressive regulation coming from, you know, Chairman Rosenwald, so a lot of that will be walked back. But at the same time, with the battles going on in the court, I think we'll wait and see kind of how that shakes out. I know that's, you know, going to come up later in the conversation. But across the rest of the innovation ecosystem, I mean, Trump has showed a hostility towards large tech companies. I don't see that pivoting. I mean, you've got this interesting dynamic now where you have Elon Musk that's seemingly the first major right-leaning platform. And I think there may be a schism there in terms of, you know, how different viewpoints politically are treated by different presidents based on how that happens. You know, I think jawboning is going to be an issue that we're going to continue to see and something that we could see there being a lot more action on. Randy.
Well, you said the first 100 days, right? Well, the first day Trump's going to be a dictator, right? No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm just using that. I want to make one point, really, which I know all of you understand, but just to be really clear, you know, the Free State Foundation is a nonprofit 501c3 think tank, and we're nonpartisan. So in the context of everything I'm discussing today, and I know we're talking about a Trump administration or a Harris administration, and that's important, but all of the my discussion's really going to be focused on, you know, what policies and they might adopt and what principles. So just to make That's kind of the backdrop, the way that I think about these things. And, you know, just right at the outset is another backdrop. You know, there are certain principles, you know, that we have at the Free State Foundation. I alluded to those before, but they're foundational to the way that we think about a lot of these things we're going to talk about. And being free market oriented is one, and that translates into generally, not invariably, but generally believing that less regulation is positive and a good thing overall for society and consumers when you have markets that are effectively competitive. In terms of, if we try and think about it, in terms of initial things, say if Carr is chair or someone else, I think one of the things that they would be thinking about would be whether the pending cases that are on appeal, like net neutrality and digital discrimination, whether those cases, and Jerry's probably maybe more of an expert on this than I am, but I think, you know, there would be opportunities to pull back those appeals, you know, which right now are pending and are two big initiatives. And so I think that, you know, that could happen, that could happen fairly quickly, and that would be significant. And then I think that the new administration would probably quickly organize a task force at the commission or some type of task force to really begin to look at which regulations could be re-examined for potential pullback. And, you know, later we may get into the specifics, but Trump has already said that he, you know, wants to repeal, what, 10 regulations for every one. That seems to me pretty unrealistic, but there's going to be a move to do that, and there was the first term. So I bet they'll get organized quickly with a process to begin to look to see how to do that, and you need a process in order to go about it, you know, in a way that is a productive and sound way.
Can I just quickly comment, Randy? You raised an important point, and it's worth a footnote. The FCC chair under precedent can act unilaterally on the repeals. So if there's a 2-2 split at the commission or whatever, then I mean that's not a partisan issue. That's a fact, administrative fact. So in terms of acting unilaterally, that is an unusual sort of feature in that regard. But anyway, Larry and Davey, let's turn to you. So first year of the Harris administration. Look a lot like the last 2 years of the Biden administration, or are we going to see, you know, some profound differences in at least a few key areas?
I would hope so. I think the Biden administration did a lot of good things, and particularly I think number one project would be continuing the affordable broadband programs. I think Chair Rosenworcel has a good relationship with both the current president and Vice President Harris, so I think it'll be a smooth transition. I would just say, too, one thing, Randy, in terms of talking about, you know, how quickly they're going to do this thing, some of the experts, the governmental public service experts, have already warned that both campaigns are kind of behind in terms of setting up transition teams. And so that's a concern as far as how quickly things could come in January. But I do anticipate in this particular area that it would be a smooth transition, not too much. You know, they might do tweaks here and there, but the fact that those relationships have been established already, I think it'll just be smooth sailing. They're probably already thinking about what they want to do right out of the first 100 days. So I wouldn't anticipate anything that people go, oh my gosh, why did they do that?
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I think given her previous work as the broadbands are, I think it's going to be a lot of focus on that work. I think it's going to be continuing to double down and show how chips and the infrastructure piece that's going to go into that is going to affect folks around the country, especially in places where maybe she didn't do as well in her election if she is, you know, elected. And I think there's a lot of factors. I think it's what's going to happen to the Senate. Is she going to have, you know, an adversarial Senate that she's going to have to work with, and a chair, you know, a leader Thune or Cornyn? And I think how the Speaker figures out funding is going to be really important. If it doesn't go to March and it gets kicked to December, it's going to be a different situation. You're going to have 100 days or 90 days of trying to figure out how to fund the government, which is going to take a lot of time, especially with a new administration working with potentially a new Congress. So I think there's a lot that's going to go into it, but I definitely agree. I think she's going to focus on what are the wins that they had the last 4 years, and how does she continue to show the value of those to the American people?
Great point. And one of the wins that the chairwoman has pointed to is closing the digital divide and all about broadband inclusion. Randy and Jonathan, you both sort of mentioned that. So in a Trump administration, what do you expect to sort of happen on the digital divide and broadband issues sort of writ large? We've already seen where there is lack of consensus in Congress on funding these, that changes are coming. There was an enormous amount of money. I worked on the Hill, and the numbers were bigger than we ever dreamed of, by orders of magnitude, and I'm not exaggerating. Is that going to continue, or would that change substantially in a Trump administration?
I think it would largely continue. You know, I think there'll be support for extending broadband to areas that don't have it, I believe, in a Trump administration. I believe there'll continue to be support for some form of low-income, support for low-income persons. Jonathan mentioned the ACP. That was one program that we're all familiar with, Lifeline. You know, they can be different names you could put on. I think there'll be support for those things, but I do think, you know, if we're realistic, I think that there will be more of a focus on efficiency in those programs, effectiveness. And for example, if we're looking at the support for the low income, and then deployments, another aspect. But, I don't think that the inclination will be to support those programs at the same level that they were supported, obviously. And frankly, to be honest with you, that's for all, you know, I've made that same point. Many of you know I've supported the Lifeline program for about two decades. I've testified on the Hill in favor of it. I was in favor of the ACP program that we lost, but I said, you know, for the last year or so that those programs need to be reformed and more focused and targeted to people that I think are the ones that are truly in need. You know, on the deployment side, you know, Trump claims he's a builder. You know, he wants to build things. I don't think he's going to back away from wanting to build out broadband. And as Jerry said, there's a lot of billions of dollars that are already appropriated, right? It's already been appropriated. I just think there will be a focus on getting it done, and hopefully quicker. I mean, we all remember in 2008, after the large amount of money that was appropriated for broadband, you know, it never, stuff didn't get built really for years. And the whole impetus for that was we were in a deep recession, you know, possibly the next Great Depression. And the idea was to, in part, that would be a stimulus. You know, it didn't happen. The money didn't go out. Now we're 2 years into you know, the BEAD program. And I get that there are processes you go through, and you have to do that, and you don't just throw money willy-nilly. I understand. But nevertheless, it's a little bit shocking, even, if disappointing, that it takes so long to get this money out the door. So I would actually hope, and I think there's some possibility, that if the Trump folks come in, they'll get it done quicker.
I'll confess, I was on the Hill in 2008, and I wrote a lot of shovel-ready speeches.
The shovel.
They weren't as shovel ready as we had thought. Well, I will be first to admit that, Jonathan.
Yeah, so, I mean, I agree with everything Randy said, so I don't want to repeat what he said. The one thing I wanted to, you know, kind of mention and flag is, you know, as Davey pointed out, Vice President Harris is the broadband czar. She's been responsible for a lot of the broadband policy of this administration. And there's been a number of things that, you know, to me, I found fairly concerning about the current administration's approach to broadband. You know, looking at NTIA with the BEAD NOFO, which is the Notice of Funding Opportunity, there's a lot of strings that have made it, you know, frustratingly prohibitive for providers to participate in the program. As, you know, Randy alluded to, we're a few years in and we haven't really seen any fruits of those labors. Obviously, you know, it does take time, but, you know, I'd hope we'd see more out of it, especially at this stage in the process. ACP was a great bipartisan success story. It was created as the EBB under the Trump administration. Vice President Harris didn't even really mention the program until after it expired. So, you know, it's great to say that, you know, we've got two candidates who both are prioritizing broadband. Unfortunately, the reality is neither really have looked at those as a priority. You know, these are successful bipartisan things historically and should continue to be bipartisan. And unfortunately, due to a very divided Congress, a lot of these great, you know, bipartisan wins that we've enjoyed over decades are sadly dwindling.
Is that even really a position? Broadband czar?
I didn't even know
people
she
keep
was.
Bringing up this thing about a czar. I mean, that was from what, the Bush administration, when people used that term czar? Immigration czar. She was the border czar. She was the broadband czar.
I didn't know she was broadband czar. I mean, I know
I just find it interesting that
I
people
knew she
like
was border
anyway.
Czar, but not broadband.
What's old is new in D.C.
Yes, yeah. always. One of the things I just wanted to add, there's a very clear line between the candidates here in terms of their approach to many of these issues. And when you look at a Vice President Harris's campaign, you see the lens is, what is the impact on communities of color? And I think they will continue to do that. We did not see that from 2017 to 2021. I think, you know, we're going to see a new generation of workers at these agencies that is going to be focused on what are the needs of these communities. And so that's what I would anticipate. I would hope, I mean, I know it's good talking points on the campaign trail that a Trump administration would view it through that lens, but we have yet to see that. So I think that's really the plans that are being laid out by the Harris campaign at this point.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think it's absolutely right. I think the Biden-Harris administration has viewed all of their policy through a lens of helping communities of color, helping minority communities, helping those in rural communities, and I think that'll continue. But I think, as Jonathan noted, I think Congress has been a hindrance. I think hyperpartisanship has made it tough for a lot of what the administration would have liked to do in a very speedy process. It's harder. That's why we have checks and balances, and that's just the, you know, that's the political apparatus we work in. So I think that's important to remember. And I think regardless of who's going to be the president, who's going to be chairman of Senate Commerce? Like, these are, I mean, that's going to mean Cruz has been pretty vocal in speaking out against a lot of these programs. And I'm happy to see that, you know, Vance has been really pro ACP, but is that going to make a huge difference if we have, you know, Chairman Cruz, if he's able to, you know, win out his election in Texas this year? That's going to be a big hindrance in terms of getting any of this done. So we can talk about the top of the ticket, but I think it's always important to remember that just on Pennsylvania Avenue, they're going to have, you know, a whole different ballgame to deal with potentially.
Really good point.
Jerry, can I just follow up, because it's related to the expenditure of the broadband funds we were talking about. The BEAD program is a big part of it, as you know, and there's billions and a few others. But because there are going to be differences, I think it's useful if we can just bring them out now, and in the way that the spending of the money, I think, is implemented in the programs. And putting aside a focus on communities of color or not, and I understand that, and I think that's probably true, but there are things that don't relate to that, but relate to what I would call the more the economics of how you do it, or the technology, and where there'll be a difference of approach. And I appreciate the differences. One, for example, is rate regulation. When you're talking about spending this money, what type of conditions do you put on it? how do you interpret the congressional language, for example, for the low-cost option to be more or less stringent for rate regulation? There'd probably be a difference of opinion there, where the Harris administration would be more strict in terms of what I would call price controls, and Trump administration not. There's a difference of approach probably in the way that they would implement the programs to either favor municipal entities or municipal governments or cooperatives, where the Harris administration would be more likely to favor those. Trump administration would not. Another one is the technologies. There's, you know, I think the Biden-Harris administration, I assume she might continue, is in the implementation of the fund disbursements, has tended to favor fiber as a preferred technology. I think a Trump administration probably would exhibit more technological neutrality. So those are things that relate to the way you implement the funding that are different.
So turning to, you know, the great parlor game in Washington is who's going to be the next FCC chair, who's going to be the next head of NTIA. I think I heard Carr and Rosenworcel already a lock for January 21st. It's going to be one or the other. So I welcome any more speculation on that front or on NTIA. But I actually want to turn to, and you can argue that personalities matter or not, but I actually want to turn to what I see is one of the biggest differences between the Trump administration's communications leadership and decision-making and the Biden administration's, and that's the relationship between the FCC and NTIA. I don't know whether you remember, but we had a time during the Trump administration where the Secretary of Commerce and the chairman of the FCC actually each accused the other person of engaging in either unilateral disarmament or treason. So depending upon which side of that debate you're on, and that's not an exaggeration, it got very nasty about a sort of exchange of letters. And I'm well aware that when Chairwoman Rosenworcel and Alan Davidson made the rounds, it's like, would you two just figure out how to get along? And I was also told, and both sides of the aisle said, that is not the way we are sort of going to function. There has to be some agreement. I think they have both worked hard to sort of have a professional relationship. There always is going to be tension. It's like the Secretary of State and the National Security Advisor. I've been at this game a long time. There was always tension. And the FCC chair has always complained about the head of NTIA, and the NTIA always complains about the chair of the FCC, and I've known many, many over the years. So it is inevitable, but it actually has never been as, for lack of a better word, ugly as it was. What do you think is, and I'm going to turn to Randy and Jonathan on this one, sort of what do you see as the relationship between NTIA and FCC in a future Trump administration, bearing on the fact that you've already mentioned NTIA was given gazillion dollars, and there's power that goes with money. And so in terms of spectrum issues, particularly in government use of spectrum, and frankly, the military's use of spectrum, like how do you see that relationship unfolding on spectrum policy and others in the new Trump administration?
Well, I'm just glad you mentioned spectrum. I know it's going to be a big issue in the debate tonight. So, I mean, the NTIA obviously has grown tremendously in terms of the scope of an agency in the last administration. Being given the BEAD program and just kind of its mission has expanded, you know, through commerce. And I think there's definitely mission creep between the two agencies. There always has been, and I think that will continue to grow regardless of whomever is in charge of the agency. I think having a clear delineated, like, task of what each of the agency's mission are and having a memorandum of understanding to draw those distinctions. You know, looking at NTIA, NTIA has always struggled as the kind of federal arbiter of federal spectrum assets and has run into, you know, headfirst into, you know, disagreements with other agencies, both DOD and otherwise, who utilize federal spectrum. And there's tension there, and that tension has always existed. FCC is just another player in kind of that game of how do we work with this agency who is kind of holding over like our biggest asset, our biggest strength. You know, the FCC spectrum auctions are one of our biggest success stories as far as tech and telecom policy. 20 years, billions of dollars to the Treasury, and, you know, unlocking this incredible wireless future that we have and enjoy and continue to enjoy. And, you know, there's tremendous uses even outside of that that we've experienced as well, you know, with unlicensed and shared use cases as well. So, you know, you look and kind of see what the FCC has done, again, in an amazing bipartisan fashion. And I think this will exist regardless of who's at the helm. I'm not, you know, kind of saying, oh, it would be so much better, you know, with Pi and Rattle or whomever, you know, is at NTIA. That tension will continue to exist. And I think it's, you know, it's behooving the, you know, whoever's at the head of the ticket to work with those agencies and really clarify, this is what you're going to do and this is how you're going to play nice together. Because I think that's really going to, you know, be a huge impediment to policy going forward.
Well, first of all, it's a real shame, of course, that Congress hadn't been able to restart the spectrum authority. I mean, that should have been done. You know, I'll just say this. It, to me, in terms of the coordination among these agencies, it seems like it really is a case of where personnel, more than some other things, personnel is policy, you know, really. I mean, there's some other issues where, you know, you could put down 3 points on net neutrality or something and go tell your, you know, officials that you've appointed, here are the 3 points, do them. You know, a lot of these spectrum things come down to questions upon which, quote, the experts disagree about engineering principles and other things. I mean, that's the way I've come to think about it after a long time. And my point really is, I think in the most recent coordination memo, the memorandum of understanding signed by Rosenworcel and Alan Davidson, if those were the principals that signed it, I think there was something, you know, towards the end of that that did establish, purport to establish a process by which disagreements would go up to perhaps even the president. Jonathan can correct me if I'm wrong. But in any event, my point really is, and it's been for some time, that ultimately, when, you know, NTIA has the responsibility initially to coordinate the executive branch's policies. We all know recent examples where it's been very difficult to do that, not just with the Defense Department. There have been other agencies as well, NOAA and others. I think it really there is important, and this is where it depends on who's has the power and who's to get decisions when they're, you know, when their agencies are at odds, to get them up through the a process, have a proper process so the views can be expressed and everything, and then you get a decision made. And, you know, if that's the president that makes it, that's fine with me. We elect whoever the president is, and then there's some accountability. I guess I would just say on balance that's preferable to having some of these things bounce around and to be delayed for as long as they've been, and where decisions are not made when the spectrum, you know, is therefore not going to be used perhaps like it otherwise would be. So I hope whoever's president puts that type of process in, and you know, and underlying what I'm saying is that I respect expertise in this area. I understand there's a lot of engineering expertise that takes place. But at the end of the day, sometimes they're just decisions that have to be made. And they can be somewhat political, and you've got to have political people making the decision.
Larry, David, quickly. So let's project out to towards the end of a Harris first term administration. The people in the chairs might not be named Alan Davidson and might not be named Jessica Rosenworcel. If in that future where it's not these two players, do you see the relationship with the FCC and NTIA sort of continuing? Because I share a lot of Randy's view that personality sometimes is politics and politics is sometimes policy. But I'm curious if how you see sort of that projecting out.
Sure. I think a real differentiator is going to be culture is set from the top. It's set by the person who sits in the chair at the Resolute Desk, and I think that's going to be, as we've seen historically, that's going to be different between these two candidates. You have a president that shoots from the hip, that has, you know, looked to attack members of his own cabinet with criticism, and that makes doing the really hard stuff that we've been talking about at the FCC and the NTIA really hard, even harder, and especially finding congeniality between the two offices when their shots being fired, you know, from all over. I think that's really tough. So I think, you know, I think the success of you know, having a very delineated set of tasks between the two organizations is going to be important to do from the beginning. I think that's certainly a transition when, you know, folks want to talk about it now, but that's going to be, you know, post November 5th. But I think if history is setting itself, I think that those are two very different personalities that will be setting the agenda there. So important to see if Trump becomes president, whether he decides to take a different approach.
I mean, Commissioner Carr has certainly been very friendly and congenial with President Trump, former President Trump.
Exactly right.
Good. So turning to a topic which, for those, I think most of the room, sort of are either in the policy advising or the legal business or both. AI is either a godsend or the scariest thing ever or both. So I had a client call me this morning, and they wanted to talk about this brand new idea that they had and what it would entail and what the regulations would entail, and it's going to be fueled by AI. And I said, I won't reveal too many of the details. I said, basically, this has been around for like 50 years, okay? And now you're just kind of having AI. And I said, am I wrong? And he says, well, it's going to be a lot better. I said, okay, I don't doubt that. But from a regulatory perspective and from a lawyer analytical perspective, it's the same thing that has been around for 50 years. It's just going to be fueled by AI. Right. And I was like, well, if I'm right about my characterization, you don't have any problems. Because it's just the same thing. On the other hand, we all have seen where AI's abilities is, you know, impressive and frightening and sort of all of those things. And understanding that Congress is going to have a big say in this, and there's not a lot of, at least in my opinion, I don't think there's a ton of authority laying around. But on the other hand, it's brand new. And maybe courts are more forgiving. Maybe they won't be. So with that big topic, and I realize we could spend the rest of the afternoon on this one. But with that sort of big topic, I'm going to start with Larry and with Davey on this one. How do you see a Harris administration sort of tackling AI? Because it is going to become more embedded. It's going to move from experimental to do it. I mean, I'm at a law firm. Clients are both like terrified that we're going to use it and angry we're not. Because how come you're wasting money if we can use AI? Why should we pay you so many hours? And so it's going to be more endemic in our daily life. Is the Harris administration going to step in, and what do you expect in terms of them sort of trying to regulate this? Worried about stifling innovation? Worried about giving it too much power? Please comment.
All of the above. Look, I think they've been at the forefront of trying to corral this thing since they've been in office. Yes, Congress is going to have a big say in this. And job number one by those of us who do the work is to educate members of Congress, because we are, unfortunately, at a really basic level of understanding. For example, one of the things I've been focused on, not so much members of Congress, but yes, we're trying to educate them as much as we can on AI. As the bills keep popping up, right, they keep sprouting up. I'm going to do this bill. I'm going to do that bill. But how will it really help ultimately the individual in the community? And I think some of you may have seen the report that came out from the advisory committee, and the number one recommendation was, let's set up a national literacy campaign on AI. I mean, there's a lot of fear in these communities, and I think that's going to help generate where we go with this. I think there is an understanding in this administration that, you know, we've been talking about financial literacy for how long now? All the programming, all the billions and dollars spent on financial literacy, and yet people still don't understand credit, right? And so lest we go down that same road with AI, I think this administration is positioned in a continuing administration to really look at it from that lens, and while continuing to educate the members of Congress who are ultimately going to be making a lot of these decisions. Again, there's so many bills. I mean, I know, for example, Senator Kelly has a bill right now on AI literacy, but will it actually, again, help that individual that right now is freaking out about, is AI going to take my job? And I think that's the bottom line.
Yeah, and I think Vice President Harris has been active with the international community on AI. I think that will continue. I think that was a great start in this administration, and I hope to see that continue, because I think we're going to see regulations abroad, regulations here. Congress, I'm sure if Leader Schumer is still leader after this election, he'll continue his work with his task force. I think it's going to be a balancing act between Congress and a Harris administration. I think there's going to be, we're going to have to align to see if what gets passed and what goes to her desk and what she signs. But I also think a Harris administration would be more willing to use sort of the levers of government to do that.
The bully pulpit. I mean, it's going to be so important.
Exactly. I think we'll hear, we'll see if she's elected, what does the State of the Union look like? Does it have a component of AI literacy? What components of AI do get included? I think it absolutely will take a lens of how do we make sure that there's not AI-driven discrimination, whether that's algorithmic or otherwise. I think that's going to continue to be a big piece of how she sees the work. But I think a Democratic administration will be more likely and more willing to use, whether it's Department of Education to have AI literacy in schools, or VA to help our veterans better understand how to use some of the new medical AI pieces. And how do we get AI in a thoughtful way that's not overregulated or underregulated in the federal government and being used in a thoughtful way to help folks?
So this is a big topic. I'm not going to let you two sit this one out.
It's a really big topic, and I'm going to say remarkably little about it, because I probably know a little about it. Let me put it this way. When you talk about AI literacy programs and educational programs and things like that, to me, they sound appealing and probably useful as we know more. And I'm assuming that you're talking about even the government supporting those and running those, I suppose. And that may be okay. But in a sort of a macro fashion, I guess I'll say this, from based on what I now know about AI, and, I was speaking for myself, but probably everyone here, we've been trying to think more about, even though it's been around maybe in different earlier forms for a decade, we've all been thinking more about it in the last year or so, right, as it's become more prominent. I have. But having said that, here's sort of the way I would, answer the question right now. But I think there obviously are a lot of benefits that society can gain from the use of AI, as it proliferates and becomes used. On the other hand, we all have in our minds ways that it can be used that are detrimental, I think, to society, right? I mean, I have some in mind, and I would worry about those.
Have you seen Twitter lately, Brandon?
I just try to see a little of Twitter each day, so we know about that there are probably potential large gains and also ills. But here's what I would say about it. Having said that, I would be more concerned about the government getting too involved in it and the regulation than I am concerned about those potential ills. In other words, I just worry about the government. Davey, I think you said something to the effect of, if the government's involved, you don't want to overregulate or underregulate. And I think you put it just about that way.
It's an art, not a science.
Yeah. And when you said that, I was just thinking, that's an absolutely brilliant statement, but it's much more difficult to pull off, to pull it off in a way that ultimately is more beneficial to society. So in line with my general inclination to let markets work and let technologies develop, until you can identify, a real threat, a real harm, and then along with that, you can identify a remedy that's targeted to address that harm, then I lean towards not having the government jump in and, you know, to put, bring this back to the way we're thinking about the panel today. I think the Harris administration, you know, because of its proclivities, would be more likely to jump in rather than the Trump administration, if I had to predict.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things with AI is it's still a nascent technology. I mean, we still haven't really even seen kind of the critical use case that's really going to be completely transformative. You know, the average person probably doesn't encounter AI necessarily in a conventional sense, you know, in their everyday life. Like, it's been happening in the background for years with, like, Google search and things like that. But, you know, day-to-day, I don't think it's really been as transformative to our existences, you know, it may be in the future. And a rush to try and overregulate or overlegislate, and there's bad bills coming from, you know, Republicans and Democrats alike, both federally and at the state level, that could, you know, critically impede the ability to really seize the opportunity and the benefit that AI can present. And I think there's genuine concern. But I think a lot of that concern can be remedied, as everyone's been saying, with, you know, looking at both AI and digital literacy. You know, we still have people in this country who don't know how to use the internet, let alone, you know, something like a large learning model. You know, that's a huge hurdle that we have to overcome to be able to, you know, talk about this technology in a meaningful way. But, you know, while we're kind of addressing this crossroad, you've got every single agency across the government looking at its, you know, a way to take a bite out of the apple, either putting out a notice and looking for comments, whether it's promulgating rules, whether it's studies, whether it's, you know, there's so many different things that every single agency looking for its own way to stake out AI because it's the buzzword and everyone has to have a piece. You know, you've got municipalities passing regulations. You've got state by state passing bills that are going to have an impact going across state lines. You've got Europe who's going above and beyond anything that we could even consider that is going to have a huge negative impact on our tech ecosystem. So, you know, it's tough because, you know, I think there are concerns, especially from a job standpoint of, you know, what jobs could be replaced by AI. But at the same time, if we have these jobs filled those roles, it provides new opportunities for people to be able to capitalize in other ways. And I think we should look for the positive and the opportunity rather than just kind of see the, you know, kind of how Skynet examples of AI.
Just to close this out, your point about the states, we have probably a dozen lawyers over the last 6, 9, 12 months who are advising clients on the, don't hold me to this number, 23 states that have laws today on AI in campaign ads. So it's theoretical who's going to be chair of the Senate Commerce Committee. Okay, the states are acting now, and, you know, in some ways, let's like privacy, you know, is the federal government going to be sort of racing to catch up? So it's really remarkable how much, and if you are, you're an online platform and you have to comply with 23 states, you have the capability, but it also sort of drives it. So AI is an issue for good or for bad that, you know, states are getting into, and frankly, I think as aggressive, if not more so, than at the federal level. So I'm going to take our conversation from really, really cutting edge to going back 90 years to the adoption of the Communications Act of 1934. And one of the core values in the very first sections of the Communications Act of 1934 is the notion of universal service. And in 1996, Congress passed legislation, and my old boss, Ed Markey, you know, considers himself the father of the E-rate program because he is the father of the E-rate program. You know, Congress actually updated it, and in drafting that legislation, we were very conscious of sort of building on the values in the 1934 Act and bringing them into the modern era. And all the language in Section 254 was all sort of written with that sort of, okay, it's our turn 60 years later at the time to sort of modernize this. Since then, the USF program has raised, I don't have the number handy, probably someone here does, a lot of money, billions and billions and billions of dollars, that has gone out to telcos, to rural broadband, to some healthcare facilities and the like. And we have sort of two crisis points sort of hitting the U.S. program from sort of different angles. One is a legal challenge, like it wasn't appropriately adopted, it's not a fee, it's a tax. Taxes have to go through one level of Congress, et cetera, et cetera. And that is a legal challenge that is alive and kicking, and they're looking for a circuit split. I share the view that ultimately this is going to be in the Supreme Court. The FCC and the Justice Department can decide whether to defend that or not. So that's the legal challenge. And the opposite end is the economic challenge. You know, we're all aware that the base is shrinking, 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 and the demand for dollars is stable or growing. And I dare say if you ever open, I know everyone here at Verizon knows what percentage they pay on the tax, but it's a big number. Help me here, 22%, 34%, okay. Not a lot of things in life where you say, oh, the bill, sir, is $10. Tack on a $3.40 surcharge, you know? So it's really remarkable, and I say that as a liberal Democrat who helped write this legislation in 1996. I was at a crisis meeting that many of you know someone conducted. The e-rate's going to go over 20%. It's going to be a calamity. There's going to be rioting in the streets. We had this summit, and a bunch of people got together. Guess what? We're at 33, 34%. So with those two existential challenges, I would dare say, from a legal challenge and from an economic challenge, I'm going to start with you two. What do you see happening from a administration leadership perspective on USF in the next 4 years in the Harris administration?
Sure. I think we'll see what comes out of Congress. I think the Senate's working on their task force, Lujan, Wicker, Thune, I believe, is involved. And I think we're still waiting on the report. I'm curious to see what the Senate comes up with. I think if it's a Harris administration or a Trump administration, they're both going to have to take a look at it. And I think there's any number of ways, and people have been writing papers and papers and papers on this, about what they could do. I mean, we could theoretically have our auction authority reinstated and use those monies instead of giving it to the Treasury, have it go towards USF programs. We could have an ACP-like program that is combined with another legacy program of USF and have ACP and that work that way. I think there's any number of ways that they can make these important reforms. And I think the consensus around this among everyone is that there needs to be reforms done and that it's not sustainable. And I think it's going to take certainly bipartisanship to get it done. And I think it's going to take an administration that's interested in bipartisanship to get it done. It's not going to be, I don't foresee, which I'll leave to election pundits to tell you who's going to control both chambers and the White House, but I don't think it'll be all three controlled by the same party. And I think it's going to take thoughtful consensus leadership to get anything done. I think we haven't had auction authority for however long. That's being used as a political chip. I think we've seen, hopefully, since it's taking a while to get this report out of Congress, that's going to be a fulsome, thoughtful, list of options that have some enough political support on the Hill to get it done. And I hope we see leadership, whether it's from, President Harris or Trump, to really make a meaningful impact there. Because it's a lot of lives. I mean, these are massive programs and important programs. And, there's bipartisanship on many of these issues to want to get something done. Obviously, we'll see how those conversations go when they get heated and serious, but I think it's hard to say which way they're going to pick because it's not just going to be a President Harris making that decision.
Anything to add, Larry? So how about you two, especially Randy? I'm curious your thoughts on the legal challenge, and Jonathan, I know you've looked at the economic challenges, so they're both profound.
Don't worry, Jonathan, I will save plenty for you here. But on the legal challenge, to be candid about it, I'm have some sympathy with the merits of the legal challenge. I've written over the years about the non-delegation doctrine, which is at the heart of the legal challenge, that Congress was not specific enough in giving direction to the FCC, and then you've got the issue of USAC, you know, being a semi-private, semi-government type of organization and having, quote, taxing authority, and whether it's a tax. I'm not predicting that that'll ultimately succeed, and to be, you know, frank with you, there are a lot of other statutes that I think are more clearly violations of the non-delegation doctrine if it happened to exist. But anyway, but I think, you know, that now, you talked about the two existential challenges to the program and referring to the rising tax slash fee on the one hand and the legal challenge. I think the legal challenge is probably now maybe greater because the consumers just don't seem, you know, the fee is, let's be honest about it, you know, it's buried on your bill, yeah, and most people don't look at it. And that was the intention, you know, that was the intention of the thing. And
because the broadcast sports fee has gone up. Everybody goes, what? $20 for what?
Yeah. So anyway, but, you know, on the merits of it, and so I'm going to, this is more like what Randy May, you know, would do or what I would advise them, because it's, I don't know what either side will do, and Congress obviously has so much to do with it. But here's the thing, and you know, Jerry knows this as many of you do. There, on some of the aspects of universal service, it's very bipartisan, right? We used to talk about the square states and, you know, meaning those areas, the vast areas in the West or Midwest that were not covered, not dense. You know, they weren't New York City. And you had bipartisanship, right, and still do on those, a lot of those issues, I think. But then you've got differences of between the parties that have emerged on, for example, the support for low-income, probably, you know, on E-rate. When you start extending E-rate to beyond the schools that I think possibly you had in mind and Ed Markey when you were doing it in the classrooms, and now are you talking about school buses and beyond, which you may not have had in mind at the time, you know, they're partisan divisions. It's hard to predict, but what I have come to believe myself is that this should be a program supported by congressional appropriations. I don't know, it doesn't necessarily have to be every year. I think there are ways to do that. You don't want to have it necessarily so uncertain, but there ought to be it's a lot of money we talk about, and, you know, I'm just of the school that it's good to have the political accountability that rather than raising the money through this, you know, tax on the phone bill. It's not going to last forever anyway, but here's just the final point I'd make, and it relates to how you do it. We've already talked about the billions of dollars that have already been appropriated to build out service to unserved areas and underserved areas. That's the BEAD program. I mean, we've done papers on this. It's over $100 billion. It's not just the $42 billion in the BEAD program. There, you know, it's agriculture. Treasury had some programs, and you can total it up. You can, you know, just from a sound, effective government review, we ought to, before we decide how much more to put into various parts of this program, we ought to see how we're going to spend that money and make sure that it's spent before deciding, oh, every year we need X amount of money.
I do have to add a historical footnote. So in writing the 96 Act, the sections actually says that the support for universal service has to be transparent. And that was actually something that the Republicans on the Commerce Committee advocated for, because before then, it was all done by AT&T as the mothership, and they overcharged business customers, and they used that money, and it all sloshed around in the system, and it was not transparent. And so it was actually considered, and I know this is like an ancient tale, but people actually used to read their telephone bill. And actually they used to see the sports fee at the bottom. They used to see the sports fee at the bottom. And people were paying attention. And that was considered reform, okay? And the Democrats went along with it, to be clear. Ed Markey said, I agree with it. So it was actually because before then it was the monopoly who just sloshed around the money and subsidized things. So it was actually reform based upon we were going to have a competitive system, and so you weren't going to have a monopoly anymore. So it was. I'm not saying today it is transparent, yeah, because we don't read our bills, but it actually is much more transparent than it was in the bad old days, where it was just sort of the mothership, as it were, the benevolent Ma Bell, right, was sort of taking care of it.
I love that word slosh, by the way, because I was going to, before Jerry said this, and you can't disprove me, that's exactly the word that I conjured up and which we always used in talking about it. It's a technical term having to do with the money in the universal service system sloshed, and it sloshed around.
Well, but it used to get sloshed around inside AT&T, and no one knew what happened. Now right. Now you actually can identify it.
Right.
So I would argue that's progress.
And last thing, I really like your point about the bipartisanship involved in this and the bipartisan voices talking about reform. I think it's super important. I think having Lujan from New Mexico, rural, native, like there's a lot of constituency there. And then having Thune from South Dakota, very different, but also very similar in many ways. And I think a way we can see the difference of who's, you know, who is sitting at the Resolute desk come next year. I mean, we've had an administration where Biden was a creature of the Senate, and I think he worked well with members on the Hill. You have Vice President Kamala Harris, who spent a lot of time in the Senate as well. I think we saw Trump for 4 years have a lot of battles with the Hill, and doesn't sort of have that knee-jerk congeniality with the colleagues that the Democrats have had. So I think that could be a piece of this. I think we saw him blow up a bipartisan border bill. I mean, that took months and months and months of work, and I think his willingness to do that is notable. And I think just in terms of style of the two, I think it's something to keep in mind.
I mean, I agree with what everyone on the panel has said thus far. I think, you know, one of the fundamental pieces is, you know, agreeing that, yes, it must be bipartisan. But I think we really are at a major crossroads as far as the future of the Universal Service Fund. And to me, there's two critical pieces of that. You've got the contributions and the distributions. And I think, you know, the fundamental way of approaching this is it has to be looking at the distributions first. We need to identify what a Universal Service Fund program is going to cover. Like, what do we need to do to close the digital divide? Like, what is a tangible goal that we are working towards over the next, say, 5, 10, 15, 20 years to ensure that people have affordable access and adult broadband to participate in the digital economy? And what do the programs need to do to reflect that? And I think our conventional, you know, approach is if we build it, they will come. And ACP proved that, you know, there's so much more on the table than just building it and they will come, because there is a customer base that even has access that still either does not connect because they either can't afford it or don't recognize the impact that it will have. And so, you know, fundamentally, I think we need to look at programs like the success that the ACP was and how do we leverage that success going forward. Then looking at E-rate and saying, okay, now we've got this program, we're bringing broadband into people's homes, what is left? What do schools and libraries and other anchor institutions actually need? Do they need digital literacy programs? Do they need any additional infrastructure? Is that covered by the BEAD program already? Then we can look at, you know, the high-cost program, which is kind of this everything but the kitchen sink type program, and say, well, we've got BEAD. We've got, you know, GEO has this amazing report highlighting 135 different programs across 16 agencies to address broadband in this country. And that's crazy. We need to consolidate that. And we are spending billions and billions and billions. And this vast chunk of the population that are on the wrong side of the digital divide aren't moving. We're not moving the needle. And we can keep throwing money at the problem, but it's not going to resolve itself if we continue to have this approach. And, you know, I laud the efforts of the working group because they are trying, but fundamentally they're keeping the existing program and mechanism that we have. And, you know, maybe it's overly ambitious on my part to suggest, but I think that's the approach we have to have. We need this, like, radical approach to addressing what are we actually spending money on? Because I think we can have a huge impact spending less, having a better program with less strings attached to get people connected and keep people connected.
Great, thanks. We are going to turn to audience questions in about 5 minutes after this question. But so I want to turn to one of the issues that Chairwoman Rosenworcel sort of really identified as a priority, and that is the digital discrimination rules. And, you know, once she got her full complement of three commissioners. This was clearly a priority, trying to sort of address redlining issues and access to marginalized groups. And there was, frankly, sharp dissents on that issue. Starting with Larry and Davey, sort of, do you see that continuing or doing more in the in a Harris administration? And then we're going to sort of quickly turn to Jonathan and Randy to address, you know, if it's Commissioner Carr, who made his views quite well known as Chair Carr, you know, what would he do with those rules? So we'll start with you all.
I think President Harris would be very supportive of these. I think certainly if Chairman Rosenworcel were to stay, I think this was a priority. As you said, she got the majority. She was able to actually act on some of the priorities that she had. So yes, I think short answer is I think these would be a mechanism that they would use to make sure that the work we're doing on BEAD, the work we're doing on other things, is not leading to additional redlining or discrimination based on where folks are and where the infrastructure is being laid.
Can I just jump in for 1 second? BEAD was exempted from the digital discrimination rules.
Sure.
I mean, it's certainly a priority for many of the organizations that are in this room and many of the folks that we work with. So, yes, absolutely. I think that will continue.
A different world in a Trump administration for these digital redlining rules?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's being challenged by the court right now. So I think, you know, they'll wait and see kind of what happens with the litigation. I think a resolution from the court will really kind of put into focus the, you know, regulatory authority that these agencies have, whether they can keep promulgating these rules that really stretch the limitations of agency power. You know, I think fundamentally my concern is I think while the aims and the ideal of what these rules are supposed to accomplish ends up more of a detriment than a benefit. We've seen that time and time again where a noble effort ends up having detrimental consequences and could actually end up costing the very same constituency that we are trying to provide these services with end up on, you know, left out because of those like policies. You know, I think a more neutral approach is a better way to help ensure that these communities are getting access. I mean, like, let's take another example of the bulk billing situation that came up at the FCC and the rules they're considering there. A lot of the communities that benefit from these bulk billing agreements are those same constituencies that the digital discrimination rules are looking to. So if we are wanting to focus our attention on these are the communities we need to provide service to, these are the communities we're trying to connect, like, if the rules are so great and they're so impactful that they're going to help with this issue, why are they being exempted from federal programs? If that doesn't tell you exactly what the rule is doing as far as it's actually harming those constituencies if they were included as part of the BEAD program.
Just quickly, I agree with a lot of what Jonathan said. I think, number one, if the FCC's rules ever were to get to the Supreme Court, I think the FCC would lose, and we get in now to the major questions doctrine and the, you know, overruling of Chevron. We, you know, I won't discuss all that, but I think the FCC, in my view, overreached in its authority when it chose primarily, you know, the big divide was choosing between disparate impact standard and an intentional discrimination standard, and the FCC chose the disparate impact standard. I think, look, everyone up here, I know, believes that there should not be intentional discrimination and that it's important that be the case, and that be enforced. But I think the FCC's decision as a practical matter, implementation matter, it would be very difficult to implement it without really overextending in itself in a way that had a deterrent effect on the company's really willingness to invest. So, you know, and I think the Trump administration, you know, most likely would take a very different view than a Harris administration on that.
Great, thanks. So as promised, open the audience to any questions for our group. I've had the fun picking wax. Hope you can too.
Yeah. I'm curious. Hi, I'm curious as to what, under a Trump administration, what does being tough on tech look like in a dereg environment? How do you take the teeth out of your regulatory agencies and then kind of keep certain factions of the industry in line? Did you want to?
What does being tough on tech look like? One thing I would say, actually, I think antitrust enforcement, this was a point I, you know, was hoping to make at some point, and it relates to your question. You know, in general, I'm in favor. I've never, you know, again, to make myself clear, when I talk about being free market, I distinguish that from being libertarian, not, you know, not being in favor of any rules. I've always been in favor of proper antitrust enforcement, or never advocated that we don't have that. So to me, the proper way, you know, I don't object to considering antitrust with regard to big tech. We've got cases like that going on right now. Now, I do think that over at the FTC and Justice Department, the way that they're interpreting their authority to downplay the consumer welfare standard, which jurisprudentially has been a guide for decades, and to introduce new ways of thinking about antitrust, which I think have to do with what I would call more social and political factors as opposed to economic, is not a good way. But that's the way to do it. But I don't know who said be tough. I mean, I'm not in favor of being, quote, trying to be tough, really, on big tech or little tech, but just have an environment in which you allow the marketplace to work as long as there aren't really, as long as there aren't competitive issues in which it can't work. And again, there are some of those. And I tend to, at this point, in the environment that we're talking about with telecom and tech, it's a much different place. And I know Jerry will admit this. And unfortunately for myself, I go back much further than Jerry does. You know, I've seen the whole evolution of our environment. And, you know, if we're all honest about it, the marketplace that we're talking about here is just so much different in terms of the alternatives available, the choices available to consumer competition. It doesn't mean we don't have issues like dealing with low-income people, getting them on. There's still those types of issues we've talked about. But that's why, you know, I'm not necessarily in favor of getting tough on big tech and to get tough on them, but just to have an environment in which companies can thrive, except when there's a real demonstrated concern about market power.
Thank you.
Yes, Deborah Chandler with Cocoa Phones.
Hi, Deborah Chandler with Cocoa Phones. So this has been a fabulous panel, particularly for us. We are working with the Lifeline programs and trying to close that digital divide from the telecom side. And we have several states that we will have over 120,000 phones out by the end of September. And hopefully through October, they will be distributed to low income. We're very excited about that. We have another 400,000 coming through first quarter and second quarter of next year. In looking at what's happening, whether we've got a Trump administration or a Harris administration, do you think those programs are going to get hit strongly? And what I find is some states, they're all broadband, even though they're not moving forward with it. And it just doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
So when you say hit, I mean, you know, as we discussed, I mean, there's a real legal challenge that, you know, the Universal Service Fund is going to hit as far as, you know, the entire mechanism for drawing those contributions.
Correct.
So I think, you know, there needs to be action from Congress to do something, whether we like it or not, even in anticipation of a potential circuit split. And I think the working group is looking very closely to find a way around that issue. You know, as for the existing program itself, I don't think there's any action from the FCC to change the program. And I think any changes to the Lifeline program isn't to, you know, gut or destroy the program, but transition it to a more flexible use program that provides, you know, more of an ACP-like service versus the very limited narrow benefit that Lifeline has. You know, the ECT restrictions that Lifeline has been prohibitive for a lot of providers. I'm sure, you know, it's a huge issue for you and as you kind of look to get customers' devices as well. So there's an opportunity, I think, more than kind of an immediate danger. It's just kind of how they approach that challenge.
I mean, certainly we're there from the commercial side because we just got accepted into Verizon's partnership program and others. But as a give back, the Lifeline program and closing that digital divide is very important to us, very important. So NTIA has been so helpful as we've moved forward. So anyway, I thank all of you for being here today because it's been a great panel.
Debbie Brillen?
Hi, and thank you. Debbie Berlin with the Project to Get Older Adults Online. We haven't talked that much about consumer protections at the FCC. I wanted to address it by talking about a popular issue for consumers, and that's robocalls. So Chairman Pai is actually the one who led the effort at the FCC to start addressing that for consumers. And it has continued under Chair Rosenworcel's efforts. So very bipartisan effort by the commission to address that big problem for consumers. I wanted you to think about consumer protections and maybe explore the next issue that you think the FCC might address in a bipartisan way that might be important for consumers.
Well, first thing I would say is, and I've told Debbie this, so I can just say, I don't understand how she can represent older Americans when she keeps looking younger every time I see her. But that's something I don't understand. But
I love you, like,
but nevertheless, having said that, robocalls. Despite anything I may have said previously, I'm in favor of do whatever you need to do to stop those things, whatever you can do. But I'll just say this about consumer protection, and, you know, I know you're the expert on it. But one thing that I will say that it relates to other things that I've said, I think that disclosure is very important, really. That's kind of the first step in a lot of these things in terms of protection for consumers to be able to understand and make choices. You know, I talked about choice earlier, all the choices we have, but if you don't understand what choices you have and you don't have disclosure, then it can be more or less meaningless. And so, you know, I've always thought that those rules, it's been part of the net neutrality proceedings. And, you know, we filed hundreds of pages of comments, but we've never argued that there shouldn't be disclosure. Those rules, there shouldn't be part of that. But the thing is, so, you know, I'm in favor of that. And then once you have rules, Debbie, the other thing I would say, and I've said this before, you can get it. It's important to be able to enforce them, and that comes up at the FCC a lot. Now, I've got some problems right now with the way they do forfeiture policy and some of the ways things are stacked up, and they're very, you know, but I've also said many times if someone violates rules, then if you have to enforce them or they lose meaning, really, and you know, again, it has to be related in a way to the violation. But those are just kind of foundational ways that I think about consumer protection.
How about you? Yeah, you was waiting before, so.
Thank you for your comments there. I was going to pick up on one of those who was back in the 50 years ago when AI was being done. I was writing coding then, and today I do teach in terms of digital literacy to our marginalized communities. My question is, when I heard earlier, too, that you were sharing that the Hill are looking at a number of ways of doing the education in the AI sector, how to do some AI literacy similar to what we're trying to do with the digital literacy part. The question is in terms of the sources that that are being used to figure out how to do that, how is that coming to the legislators? How are they relating directly to the communities themselves in terms of shaping what would look like the kind of training programs that would be useful to them and relevant for them in terms of doing that? I'd be interested in terms of how they're working with resources who are providing that information on the legislative side. So regardless of whether it's a Trump or Harris administration, as you mentioned, the Hill itself is going to be critical in terms of how that comes out in the public. So I was going to ask if you could give some suggestions on
sure.
what they're doing now to do that and what are some ways that you would suggest would be the best ways to source
really good
that.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can certainly speak to that. I'm aware of a number of efforts happening right now, whether it's the Congressional Black Caucus or the Hispanic Caucus. The Tri-Caucus, as we like to talk about it, is certainly getting together and discussing a lot of this. But the CBC has been at the forefront already in terms of having roundtables and really encouraging their members to get knee-deep into the subject matter. I helped organize something with the Congressional Hispanic Caucus recently with some not-for-profits who were, you know, talking about and committed to this whole idea of a national literacy campaign. I know that they're also reaching out to the companies. I don't think any of this can happen without the major companies being involved. The issue you have to get past with working with the companies is, of course, they all want to promote their own tools, but that's okay too. So it is happening because they're hearing it directly from their consumers. Again, I use the word, you know, people freaking out and fear. That fear is real about, you know, what does this mean? I saw a piece, you know, on the news, or I read about it, you know, online, and I am concerned. I'm a data entry, you know, worker. You definitely need to be worried about AI in that case. So they have to hear directly. We're encouraging them to go into, you know, do town halls. And I know a number of folks led by Congressman Ted Lieu on the Democratic side, Mr. Rounds in the Senate, who's one of the co-chairs of the Senate AI Task Force. They're all kind of looking and saying we need to be in these communities. We can't do it from Washington like we always do, right? We have to be talking to people directly.
That's a really good forward-looking question and answer, and so I want to be respectful of people's time, and so why don't join me in thanking our great panel here.